So this is the end of 212 for this quarter, and we saved the best for the last. So first I'll tell you about Nathan Lewis. He is a professor here in pediatrics. He has his undergraduate degree in biochemistry, came and did bioengineering here at UCSD. Spent time as postdoc at Harvard with George Church, looking at genome editing methods and their uses. And then he was a professor in Utah, BYU, for a while until he decided to come back here to San Diego and grow a career. And you've been here for what, 3 years now?
About 3 years, yeah.
Yeah, going from basically stepping through the door to running a big program on CHO cells, as well as human cells for various applications to human disease. So just without stealing his thunder, just hoping that some people will come in before making a noise on tape. CHO cells are mammalian cells, they're cancer cells, isolated from the Chinese hamster ovary. And they make now about something like $80 billion worth of product a year. The biologics business is now $140, $50 billion a year. Very high profit margin set of products. So CHO is probably the most important cell line, industrially speaking, with respect to generating profit. You know, once you have an approved therapeutic, it gives you a license to print money. It's really a printing press once it gets going. So up until about 2010, dealing with CHO cells was an art. It was all black box. You tried this or tried that, and you learned to play tricks with your cell line. In 2011, under Nate's leadership, the CHO K1 cell line was sequenced and published in Nature Biotech, and that's now been almost exactly 6 years ago. And that kind of ushered in the genome era for CHO. In the beginning, the industry was quite resistant because this was kind of opening up the black box. I could expose dirty laundry, who knows what. But it became pretty clear that as a part of regulatory approval, process monitoring and so forth, sequencing would be important. 2013, Nate led another important project that also published in Nature Biotech, which was sequencing the animal that the cell line came from, the Chinese hamster itself, in a series of cell lines. That gave the first kind of glimpse into the genomic basis for CHO cells and their function. And since then, he's just kept going. He did led an international consortium to reconstruct the metabolic network for CHO. He's reconstructed the processes that are involved in protein secretion, glycosylation, folding, and all of these things, and has built models of that that are predictive. So he is going to be a big player in basically transforming this CHO business from something that is really scientifically poorly known to something that's quite explicit and hopefully deeply understood.
Yes.
So, you're excited to hear what you have to tell us.
Thanks. Yeah, thanks for the chance for me to present this work. So today I'm going to give this about the first two-thirds of my talk will be about kind of how do you use these computational models for mammalian cells to produce high-value pharmaceuticals. Then I'm going to talk about in the last part of going a little bit more broad and to say, well, how do you build cell line specific models? And so, again, I want to step back and think, why are we here? Well, a lot of us were here to get training. We're here to get a job. And oftentimes we want to think about, well, how can we take our tools to solve world problems? So start to think about, okay, what problems have already been solved? So in the past 100 years, these are what have been ranked as the 9 inventions in the past 100 years that have probably saved the most lives globally. So some of them are, you might go back to your chemical engineering training, you'll remember the Haber-Bosch process, which produces liquid ammonia from air and water, basically from air components. And again, this has provided nutrients for plants and fertilizers, and has enabled the production of higher crop yields. Okay, so great, that's been solved. Can't do that. Well, if you look at this, biotech has accounted for 5 of these top 9 approaches. Some of them are blood transfusion technologies. Okay, and so you can see that being able to get good blood products to people has saved plenty of lives, as has a lot of genetic engineering and crop engineering. And then you have also vaccines, antibiotics, and insulin. Now, if you look at these, Several of these, particular vaccines, in some cases antibiotics and insulin, have been enabled because of cell factories. So right here we have a cute little cell factory. You have the nutrients will come in, and you have these little cute guys inside of the cell. They'll go through and manufacture whatever product you're trying to do and export it, whether it be a vaccine or antibiotic, maybe insulin. And you have right here the nucleus kind of programming everything, making sure everything's moving nicely in your factory. So this is a major goal in the biotech industry, is being able to figure out how can we make complex molecules through using living organisms. And so there's a whole field of metabolic engineering that has been thriving for a number of years, and they've been able to make quite a few different products from a living organism. And these are going to be a lot of products that previously were only attainable through chemical processes, through petroleum products and such. So this is all nice, and I think that there's a huge amount of literature on this space, but what about something a little more complex? So what about high-value pharmaceuticals? Now, we've seen the potential of a lot of these pharmaceuticals, again, helping many people globally. But a lot of them, when you start thinking about pharmaceuticals, you frequently start thinking about molecules like this, things that maybe bring back nightmares of organic chemistry, the synthesis problems they have you work on. But if you look at the top-selling drugs, in last year, these numbers just came out, I think, last week. You can see I have highlighted 8 of these. Now, these 8 are not what you usually think about in this sense. These are the ones, they're not the ones where you have these cute, colorful liquids that are produced through these processes with all these great lighting that brought me to chemistry. I was originally a biochemistry major, and I loved a lot of this thing until I found out everything was colorless. And most labs don't look like this. Instead, these 8 of these 10 are actually, my thing's not working. That's why it popped up on my laptop. Okay, there we go. They're actually proteins. Okay, so when you start thinking about synthesizing a protein, you're thinking about a completely different process. And something happened right here. Okay. Let's jump through this real quick. Maybe my remote control is dying.
Don't worry, mate, we'll edit this out.
Okay.
Won't be scrambling on YouTube.
There we go. Okay, so 8 of the 10 are actually proteins. And as Bernard mentioned, the global spending on biologics alone passed $140 billion in 2013, and it steadily has been increasing each year since then. It's a nice report where they actually break down the global biologics industry and about where the funds are being used or coming from, which host cells are being used, and so forth. Well, if you look at these 8 proteins that are among the top 10 selling drugs, 5 of them are actually producing Chinese hamster ovary cells. So the first question is, why Chinese hamster ovary cells? Well, I'm going to give you a little bit of a history. So back in 1948, some scientists saw the value of Chinese hamsters. Now, Chinese hamsters have 11 chromosomes, which is a lot fewer than other mammalian models. But the chromosomes, or the genome, is close to the size of the human genome. It's about 2.7 gigabases. And there was also some fragility to it. So they looked at it and thought, this might be a good model organism to study this weird phenomenon that we see with breaking of this DNA that seems to has to underlie cancer. And so they were smuggled out of China, and unfortunately there were some officials back in China that thought we were smuggling them to infect them with the plague and parachute them back over, our enemies. To my knowledge, this never happened. Of course, the US government. What we do know that happened was in 1957, George Yerganian, he was a scientist at what is now the Dana-Farber Cancer Institute. He had a colony of these hamsters, and he was using them for for studying diabetes and in cancer. And at one point, he shipped one of these, in 1957, he shipped one of these hamsters to Theodore Puck, another scientist out in Colorado. And Puck was doing a study in which he was taking cells from a number of different organisms and bombarding them with mutagens to really understand the mutation process. And what happened was all the cells were dying that he was testing, but these hamster cells that he extracted from an ovary of this Chinese hamster kept on growing. They kept on growing. And so what happened was that he started sharing them. The postdocs in his lab started taking them with them to other places. And it became what was, for a number of years, what was the mammalian equivalent to E. coli. A lot of our understanding of mammalian cell biology was originally discovered in Chinese hamster ovary cells. It was a major host for a lot of studies. Now, in the late 70s and early 80s, when people are thinking that, well, maybe we could take proteins that people are defective in, so they've been identifying the cause of hemophilia and some of these other diseases that was genetic. Could we take some of these proteins, express them in a cell, and use that as a new pharmaceutical? And so they found that there were some challenges that required them to use mammalian cells for this, but they found that these CHO cells, they were able to efficiently express large amounts of human protein in these cells, and that it didn't have the immunogenic response that you would get if you tried to express the proteins in plants or some of the other mammalian cells. And basically, they found that it gave human-compatible post-translational modifications. And so what happened in 1987, we had the first FDA-approved mammalian-produced pharmaceutical. And this was a tissue plasminogen activator. It was produced in a CHO cell line. And as Bernard mentioned, about 70% of the mammalian-produced pharmaceuticals are produced in Chinese hamster ovary cells, which accounts for more than 35-38, somewhere around there, percent of all biologics. So it makes it the primary production host among all other ones for biologics. And so how can we use these cells, how can we further improve these? So there are some major challenges that the industry has faced. Now, as Bernard mentioned, we had the opportunity to lead some new efforts to bring in new technologies that rely on the genome. But what are the real problems that companies are facing? First, they need to figure out how to get these cells to produce as much protein, as much therapeutic as possible. And so you have to take these therapeutic proteins, oftentimes they're human proteins or engineered genes, and get the cell to produce them when they don't really want to be produced. They get no benefit out of producing those proteins. And so how do you drive up the amount of protein? Well, in the past, what they would do is they just mutagenize a lot of cells, and they'd pick clones and that were producing a large amount. Or they'd couple it to a transgene that they could force to be highly expressed by using a drug treatment that would then your drug would actually would just get kind of pulled along and produce at high amounts. So the main challenges they're running into is, how do you get these transgene to express more efficiently? How do you get it to translate efficiently? How do you get it to be transported out of the cell? How do you get to get folded and post-translational modified correctly in the ER and Golgi? And then how do you get the cells to grow to higher densities? Because you think if you can get your cells to grow to higher density and more cells, it means you can produce more protein. And so these are some major challenges that people have been trying to solve for a number of years. And with actually quite a bit of success to some degree, but there's still a lot of challenges out there. Another thing that's been more difficult to optimize is protein quality. Now, when you look at these cells are not only secreting your drug, they're secreting a lot of other proteins, a lot of host cell proteins, a lot of CHO proteins. So that's going to be stuff like proteins that could potentially induce an immunogenic response if you get inside of a human, because it's non-human. Or it could be proteases or glycosidases or something like that actually chew up your drug. And so you have to figure out how to control for this. And so in the biopharmaceutical space, what they've done is they've done a lot of optimization of developing purification processes after you get the protein. And there's also been a concern with contamination. Now, CHO cells have been a lot better at that, where they don't get virus infections as readily, but it's something they have to screen for. Another thing you have to kind of look at is on each of the proteins, so each of these little protein right here, if you look at them, they have these post-translational modifications. You can see right here, this is an antibody right here in the middle. Those are glycans. Now, what are glycans? For those of you who aren't familiar with them, they're basically chains of sugars that form these branching structures. So each of these different squares, triangles, circles, each of those is a different type of sugar. So the greens, for example, are mannose. This is a galactose. This is glycanac. This is a fucose. Now, it's important what these look like because they significantly impact the efficacy and safety of your drug. We'll talk a little bit more about that. But this is one of the major challenges in the pharmaceutical industry is controlling these post-translational modifications. And you'll understand a little bit more later on in my talk why that is. And then, of course, as for any company, time is one of the major challenges. How do you get your cells to produce protein a lot faster? So if you're basing your whole system off of just shoving your gene into a cell and then mutagenizing it and trying to get it to overproduce, there's some challenges right there. Are there ways that we can speed this up by getting things integrated in a very predictable fashion? And then also making sure that not only after you get it in there and producing a high amount, making sure it keeps producing the whole lot. Because again, it does no interest in really producing that protein. And so there are native processes that can sometimes silence your gene expression. So you can see, for example, one clone might continue to have a large amount of expression over the course of a few months. Others might decrease in expression. So you have to be able to ensure the stability of your clones. So these are some of the major challenges that industry has been trying to face. And so the question is, can we rationally engineer the cells to solve each and every one of these problems? And that's something that we now are looking into. In the past, they did random screening. Can we rationally engineer it now? So when we start thinking about engineering a system, we kind of want to understand what does the system look like. So if I were to open up my car hood and think, well, I don't really like the way that catalytic converter is working. I need to understand all the little parts if I'm going to think about engineering anything more effective. So let's open up the one of these cells. Okay, right here, this is the nucleus of an antibody-producing cell. You can see that you can recognize a lot of the parts here. Here's your DNA. And you have right here an RNA polymerase making some RNA. This is your spliceosome. So you can see some other transcription factors and regulatory proteins. Okay, so that kind of makes sense. Now, what happens next? Well, after your RNA gets spliced, it gets transported through the nuclear pore and eventually grabbed on by a ribosome. It starts getting translated in the ER, and eventually, you can see that it continues to get folded and post-translation modified the Golgi, eventually gets packed into one of these vesicles and eventually secreted. Okay, that's a pretty simple process, right? So suddenly, you actually want to go to your car right now. You'd much rather engineer your car than a cell because of the complexity. And these are just the parts that we know about that influence the process. There's a lot of other genes that we continually are trying to understand better. So can we think about actually rational engineering a cell? Well, we're doing it for E. coli. There were three major drivers that have allowed us to engineer E. coli in a rational fashion, and it allows us to get, a decent number of products are being produced in microbes, in yeast, and E. coli, and others now. And what enabled it? Well, first, we got a list of the parts. So you can think about cracking open the cell. We now have a list of the parts. We sequenced the genome now 20 years ago. And then quickly thereafter, we started having people map out all the cellular pathways, the metabolic pathways, regulatory pathways, protein-protein interactions, and things like that. And that kind of gave us a view of how all those parts were connected. So that makes it a little more tractable if you understand how everything's connected. Then, around the same time, efficient engineering genome editing techniques were being developed for yeast and E. coli. And so that allowed people to start to think about, well, I can start swapping in and out parts and be able to get the pathways in there that I need or modify the cells to remove things that are inhibiting my production of the molecules we're trying to make. And so we have a metabolic engineering industry now that utilizes these tools to engineer microbes. What do we have? So you can see right here, there's a lot of different, as I already showed earlier on, there's a lot of different compounds that people have been able to produce efficiently in microbes. How about CHO cells? Okay. We have decades of information on the hamster, on the CHO cells, and how they behave in bioprocessors, and the bioprocess approach steps, but we don't know. We haven't known much about that. And that's where we started to be able to crack open this black box when we sequenced the genome of the CHOK1 cell line and then the hamster itself. Now, this that gives us a sequence and the annotation that kind of gives us the parts list. We've also been able to start using the genome to help us guide other efforts to fully characterize all the other cellular parts. And so that gives us the proteome, the transcriptome, the translatome, the secretome, so basically everything that's being secreted. And then we can also characterize metabolome and glycome. And so we're starting to get a much clearer picture of what makes up these cells. Now we can start think about taking all those parts and stitching them together into the network. So right here we have the metabolic networks, all the pathways required to synthesize proteins and also to make the post-translational modifications that are important for the efficacy and safety of these drugs. Okay, so we have the parts, we have the interactions, and just so happened that a few years ago, we finally got efficient genome editing tools, so we can actually go in and start mixing and matching, swapping things in and out of these cells. So now we can finally think about engineering these cells. And so I'm going to talk about some of the modeling stuff we've been doing in this process of trying to rationally engineer these cells. So this right here is a snapshot of the secretory pathway in a CHO cell. And so you can see right here, your gene, as I mentioned earlier on, your gene will be expressed in the nucleus, be translated into the ER, get folded, processed, have some QC/QA and so forth in there. And eventually it gets passed to the Golgi where it receives its some of the post-translational modifications and so forth. Glycosylation occurs there by and large. And then you have metabolism that's basically providing all of the resources for all those steps. And so what we've been doing is we've been mapping out all of the processes in each of these steps. So for example, right here we have an interaction map of all of the components that are important for synthesizing and processing the proteins in the ER. Of course, this is just an interaction map. We're trying to, and where we can, we've been mapping out actually the biochemical processes that occur. As you can see right here, we have a ribosome producing a protein right here, translating it. It's actually, this is the inside of the ER. So we've been mapping out as many of these processes as possible, and I'll talk a little bit about that project. We've been also mapping out all the pathways for synthesizing all these complex glycan modifications that you see on the proteins, shown right here. And so I'll talk about that a little bit later. And then we also been, as Bernard mentioned, we got the chance to lead a global effort to reconstruct all the pathways, all the metabolic pathways in Chinese hamster ovary cells. This was really a concerted effort with people from all over the world. In fact, we got people from six of the continents involved in this. Unfortunately, we couldn't find anyone from Antarctica, so it wasn't truly global. But we got a lot of great people that were working on this together, and I think that we came out with a very high quality reconstruction of all the cellular pathways. And so, now let's all talk a little bit about that first. So, as you know, you don't need much introduction to this after this class, but how do you build a genome scale metabolic network? Well, first you have to identify all the enzymes in the genome, you find their specificities, and then stitch the reactions together into these pathways, right? And then you can use these with various inputs. For example, if you know what the cells are going to be doing, in other words, all the building blocks for growing more cells and producing protein come from metabolism. So you can just take those and link them to your growth, your objective, your biomass objective. If you have your metabolite uptake rates, you bring those in. And then if there's any genetic or expression changes, you can bring those into then run simulations to see how that influences the flux and ultimately growth and protein production. So you'll be able to predict those things. Okay. Now, what does this network reconstruction look like for the Chinese hamster ovary cell? It has almost 7,000 reactions in it and accounts for more than 1,700 genes in the hamster genome. So we've gone now in the last few years from knowing almost nothing about CHO cell metabolism to now where we have it mapped out pretty well. We're able to predict things like growth and protein production. How well does it predict growth? Here are the predicted growth rates for a number of different cell lines from different studies using different data sets. And you can see, by and large, we're relatively close to the actual measured growth rates. And so this happens to be a lot more close to the measured rates than has been reported for almost any other mammalian cell lines. And so we're feeling pretty good about this. So we have a good match of how much material is going into the cell and how much is being translated into growth. But of course, we're interested in cell lines, okay? And as you've probably been talked about here in this class, not all genes are going to be expressed in a cell line or any given tissue for that matter. And so there's a lot of algorithms out there that allow you to take expression data to identify which genes are expressed and then incorporate phenotypic data to make cell line specific models. So we did that for a number of different CHO cell lines. And we started looking at it and say, well, can we learn anything about Chinese hamster ovary cell metabolism? And so the first thing we did as more of a validation was we looked at essential amino acids. Now, these are the essential amino acids for human. And so you open up any biochemistry textbook, they'll have these listed. Is it the same for hamsters? Well, for CHO cells, it's been reported that we have four more essential amino acids, arginine, asparagine, cysteine, and proline. Was our model able to recapitulate these amino acid essentiality phenotypes? So we looked at these, and we first looked to see, well, for the Chinese hamster, so the little box represents whether or not the gene is expressed or identified. All the genes for producing these were actually found in the genome. But when you actually look at expression, so this is the box is if it's expressed in the hamster, and if it's green, it's expressed. If it's not, if it's white, then it's not expressed. And then we have right here several different cell lines, and these represent whether they were in the transcriptome, the proteome, or on the right side of the circle, whether they were recapitulated in the model. And then so you can see right here, arginine actually is not expressed in this reaction, is actually not even expressed in the hamster. And so that would explain why the hamsters are arginine, why arginine is an essential amino acid for hamsters, and I believe also for rats. The rats get really sick if you don't provide them arginine. They have the gene so they can express it, but it's not natively expressed. And so you can see right there, this pathway is actually not being produced, is not being added to the model because the genes aren't expressed. Now you can look at cysteine. Again, similar case, except for that it is produced in the hamster but not in these cell lines, and it's not expressed. Proline is commonly studied in hamster cells as far as its essentiality. What we found here is kind of a mixed package. You can see there's two pathways that go to form proline. We have steps in different cell lines that are not expressed. So it leads to very likely a very much limited ability to produce proline. One thing that was interesting was that it was reported that asparagine was also essential in a CHO cell line in one paper. So we looked at this one, and everything in our data and our model said, no, it's not essential. And so we were like worried about the accuracy of our model, so we actually went and grew these cell lines without asparagine, and they were happy as can be. And so really it comes down to that, in that one publication, that one cell line that had, it actually had had an essentiality that is just probably wasn't expressed in there. But in general, CHO cells are fine there. So this gives us some confidence in this model that we're able to actually accurately predict these essentialities. So what can we do with these genome scale models? There's a number of metabolic challenges in recombinant protein production. One of them is making sure the cells are happy, that they have the nutrients they need. One of them is making sure they're not producing toxic byproducts. Lactic acid and ammonia have been classic ones that have been studied. There's several others that have been recently reported. And so I won't get into it, but you could potentially use these to eliminate lactic acid secretion, and we've been able to do that. And then beyond that, however, As I mentioned before, metabolism is intimately connected to protein production. So there's a lot of changes in metabolism can influence protein production and glycosylation. So basically, what you could do is you could go back and look to see each cell line is going to have a different set of mutations. How many of these hit glycosyl, or how many of these hit metabolism? How does it influence protein production? So we've been able to do that, and if you're interested in that, you can talk to me later. You can also use this to optimize media for growth or your product, so I'll talk a little bit about that later. You can use that to assess if the proteins are producing as much protein as they, if the cells are producing as much protein as they could, in theory. You could also use them to guide glycoengineering, to make sure you get the right glycans that you need. Or you could use them to engineer desired metabolic traits, again, eliminating lactic acid secretion, ammonia, and things like that, among others. So as I mentioned, I'm going to talk about these three today, and we'll go from there. Okay. So first, what you'll see, if you look at the history of CHO cell protein production in CHO cells, this is going to be for monoclonal antibody production. You can see that this is going to be the number of days we're growing the cells, and this is going to be in blue is going to be the cell concentration in a bioreactor. And this in red is going to be the amount of protein you're producing. You can see that in 1987, they couldn't get the cells to grow very densely, and you couldn't produce very much protein. But in the first 20 years of the biotherapeutics industry, the CHO-based biotherapeutics industry, they were able to significantly boost the amount of protein you could produce, and a lot of it seemed to follow the ability to get the cells to grow more densely. So the question is, have the cells kind of already maxed out their ability to produce protein? Is it just a matter of fact, a matter of just getting them to grow more densely? And so we decided to look into that. Now, if you have a CHO cell, if you're getting it to grow, it's going to be actually It's going to be against the production of protein because they need a similar set of nutrients. Can we actually figure out if these? And so there's a number of different treatments out there that actually inhibit growth at one point. And the idea is that you're going to allow the cells to produce more protein. So the question we had was, are these cells efficiently trading their growth for protein production in this strategy? So what we did is we took the model, we defined the biomass production rate, so how quickly the cells were growing. We defined the amount of metabolites, or the metabolite consumption rate going into the model. And then from there, we're able to predict the maximum amount of protein that the cells could actually produce. And so then we simulated the cells to see, as you add these different treatments to decrease growth, if the cells were efficiently switching the nutrients that were being freed up for growth to actually produce higher amounts of your protein. And so what this plot right here, this says basically how much they knocked down, they were able to knock down the growth using sodium butyrate, which is a histone deacetylase. That has been known to boost protein production, or by engineering the cells to have more chaperones and other proteins expressed in them, or if you inhibit apoptosis, how that actually influences the growth and the protein production rate. So you can see right here, by treating with different concentrations of sodium butyrate, you decrease the amount of the growth rate of the cells, but you only slightly increase the amount of protein being produced, where the QP is the amount of protein produced per cell. And so, yeah, it does boost protein production, but doesn't really do so efficiently. This is going to be, if it efficiently moved all of the resources from growth to protein production, it would be up here in this region of optimality. And so it's boosting protein production, but not efficiently. If you inhibit apoptosis and then treat with sodium butyrate, it gives a comparable boost in protein production, but you do get more protein produced just because the cells are growing faster, but it's not, still not anywhere near the maximum amount that you, in theory, could produce. If you, however, you overexpress a few secretory pathway proteins, some chaperones and so forth, you can get a much higher increase in the amount of protein produced per cell. It's still not the theoretical maximum amount. In fact, if you look at it, a lot of these approaches only give you about 10 to 15% of what you could, in theory, get out of the proteins. In other words, only about 10 to 15% of the resources that are freed up here actually go to produce your product. Whereas if you get the right chaperones and so forth, you can significantly boost that. But it suggests that there's potentially more room for engineering. And so we started thinking about this. Well, can we start freeing up resources more in these cells? And so as I mentioned before, we started mapping out all of the cellular pathways for synthesizing and producing and secreting proteins in the ER and Golgi. And so we identified all the different proteins that were important for different processes such as glycosylation, protein folding, protein synthesis, and so forth. And found there was about 261 proteins involved in the secretory pathway. We were able to reconstruct some of the biochemical mechanisms right here. So you can see right here, this actually gives you the exact mechanisms for how you're producing the protein, including the cost of each step. So you can start to compute how expensive is a protein to produce for a cell. So that way you get the accurate constraints on the cell to make sure that, to understand how much it costs. And then what we were thinking you could do is you could take these costs and what sort of competition there is for producing these proteins with a number of endogenous proteins. And so in building this model, we take this model and couple it to the entire metabolic network, and so that we were able to compute at different growth rates how much of these, of a number of different drugs could you actually produce in theory. So right here we have different, like the bone morphogenic protein 2, you have erythropoietin, you have factor 8, and some antibodies. This basically shows that as you control the growth rate, how much protein you can expect to get them to produce. So we actually did this for a number of different recombinant protein drugs to see what is the cost of them and how does that compare to the cost of all of the proteins that are actually secreted by CHO cells in general. You can see that you get the whole distribution here. Some of the drugs we want to be able to produce are incredibly expensive for the cell to produce compared to what it's used to producing in red. Right here, these are the hamster proteins. Some of them are closer. EPO, for example, is a smaller protein, not very expensive to produce. So it gives an overall view of how much it costs to produce a protein. So we started thinking about, well, how much energy, that's how much it can cost to produce one mole of a protein. How much is a cell actually spending on those proteins? Because some of them are going to be expressed at very high amounts, some of them are going to be expressed at very low amounts. And so in an experiment with some colleagues of ours, we did ribosomal profiling on a CHO cell line that's producing a recombinant antibody. So basically, if you're not familiar with ribosomal profiling, basically what you're going to do is you're going to pull down all the actively translating ribosomes and sequence the fragments of RNA that they are sitting on top of. And so that gives you an idea of how much ribosomal potential is on each mRNA and where is it actually also on it. And you can normalize it out also by doing RNA-seq in parallel. So you can know what are the cells making in the ER and the cell in general. And are there proteins that your cells are producing that are serving as distractions that you could potentially eliminate, thus freeing up more resources to produce more protein? And so what we have right here is over time, we were growing the cells, and you can see that you get this normal growth, this standard growth curve. We took samples from day 3 and day 6 and started looking at the protein production at those different rates. Time points. Now what this plot right here, this shows what is the CHO cell producing or using its ribosomes on at day 3. So you can see right here, while it's actively growing, it's producing cytoskeletal proteins like actin. And you can see there's some translation factors right here. This is one of the chaperones. You can see it's spending a lot of time translating ribosomal proteins. Here's metabolism. So spending a reasonable amount of its translation potential on metabolism. And then you can see right here, here are the heavy chain and light chain of your antibody and this selection marker, NEOR. And so this kind of gives us an idea that, yeah, our cells are spending quite a bit of its translation potential producing your antibody, But there's other stuff here that it's spending a lot of time on. Some of it is going to be essential, some of it's going to be not. Can you efficiently bump material that's being spent on one of these factors to your antibody? And so what we did is we knocked down NeoR. NeoR, as I mentioned, was a highly expressed selectable marker. Wasn't needed anymore in the cell. And so we used an siRNA just to knock it down. You can see right here, this is the mRNA expression level at day 3 and day 5 of the bioprocess. And you can see that it didn't significantly change transcriptional rates of the mRNAs. But what about protein production rates? Well, over time, we found that the cells were able to grow faster when you knock down this product that was not necessary. It was basically just hogging resources. But what about protein production? Well, we saw that the titers were able to significantly increase, especially over time. Now, when we went back into our model of the secretory pathway and said, well, what happens if you knock down NeoR? The model predicted you'd get a 4% increase in productivity at day 3. And that the model also said you get a 29% increase in productivity by day 5, or day 6. And day 5 is when we have to do the measurement. And right there we had an 18% boost. So the model was able to predict that by knocking down genes that are basically competing for resources, you are able to effectively get the cells to produce more of your recombinant drug of interest. So in summary, for this first part, we were able to build a large genome-scale metabolic network of Chinese hamster ovary cells, and we were able to demonstrate that the cells still have room for improvement for producing more recombinant protein, more efficiently. And we were able to extend this model to incorporate all the mechanisms of the secretory pathway and demonstrate that we can free up resources by eliminating unnecessary genes. So then moving on, we're interested in improving not only the amount of protein produced, but also the quality. Now if you look the things that influence quality, one of the things that the industry is most interested in is glycosylation. Why glycosylation? Well, these are these sugar chains that basically are attached to more than half of the mammalian proteins, and they basically cover the outside of a lot of mammalian cells. And so when you see pathogens coming to infect cells, they oftentimes they grab onto these sugar chains and use those as co-receptors. A lot of proteins use these glycans to influence how efficiently they fold. And then a lot of immune responses are actually targeted at glycans. So do we really care about their structure? Well, this is the glycan attached to the Fc region of an antibody. Each of these different colors is a different type of sugar. Again, mannose is right here, glucagon, galactose, fucose. And you can see that it kind of sometimes will wrap around and kind of aid in the structure of a protein. The structural biologists will chop them off because they make them harder to crystallize, but they actually are a fundamental portion of the protein, of the function of the folding and structure of the protein. And you can see just by changing individual sugars, so taking this galactose off, you can make this antibody have more of a pathogenic response. If you remove the fucose and some of these other sugars, you can make them have a pro-inflammatory response. Or if you silylate, it'll have an anti-inflammatory response. Now this significantly impacts the efficacy of for example, anti-cancer antibodies, monoclonal antibodies. So we do care about these glycans substantially. So you just want to change them, right? Just knock out a gene or something like that, right? Well, unfortunately, glycans don't come in isolation. They are synthesized in these complex pathways. And so the question is, if you're going to change this one, you're also going to be influencing these other ones. In fact, if you knock down this gene to boost the production of this glycan, yeah, you'll decrease the production of those ones, but you also increase the production of some of the precursors. And this is actually a very simple view of glycosylation. It's actually a lot more branching to it. And so it makes it kind of complex. Just to make things even more complex is that you have to worry about these substrates. Now, there's sugar. These sugars basically come in the form in which they are loaded with nucleotides on them. And so the concentrations of these are going to influence ultimately the efficacy and of these reactions. Then you have enzymes that you have to worry about their individual activities, and they like to compete for substrate. So both of these two will be competing for that substrate. This one will add this glucose, this one will remove a mannose. Okay, so you have competition there. Now you have inhibition of certain enzymes coming from metabolites and also at the transcriptional regulatory level. So a very complex system right here. There's a lot of different steps and everything's highly connected. It's been actually a major challenge in the field. We oftentimes ignore glycosylation because of this complexity. But in the pharmaceutical space, you cannot ignore it. And so can we start using a systems approach to understand this process and figure out how to modify it and control it? So I'm going to talk about how you can figure out, using these approaches, what changes will get you a desired glycoprofile, and then what is the genetic basis of a perturbed profile. So as I mentioned, this is a quite complex process. You can start with one glycan that's added to your shirt, to your protein, and then after a few steps, you can form all these other ones in the cis Golgi. They get passed to the medial Golgi, and again, there's more reactions, more changes, more types of glycans. And eventually, you can see with each enzymatic step, you can get more and more and more complex glycans, and there's more and more of them. In fact, once you get to the glycans commonly found on some of these therapeutic proteins, there's thousands of potential glycans you could get, and thousands of different reactions also. In fact, it scales with the complexity of your glycan, it scales almost exponentially in the number of structures you can get. So it's a challenge when you start thinking about it. Now, do we see all these glycans? And the answer is no. These are the dominant glycans produced by a Chinese hamster ovary cell. It's not this exponentially increasing. Now the challenge though, is you look at this, this is a very complex molecule. This is going to be one of these thousands of potential ones way out here. And so what makes a cell choose this profile, these glycans, over all the thousands of other potential ones? There's a number of things. The abundance of the different enzymes, the alleles you have, mutations in them can influence it. The structure of your protein influences whether or not the enzymes can get in and make modifications. The size of your endomembrane system. And there's a number of other components too that influence this. But this is what we get. And so efforts to model glycosylation oftentimes focus on just measuring enzymatic parameters of individual proteins, and hopefully those will work out all of this. And so it's been a challenge in even using kinetic models and so forth. And so we decided to take a different approach. We said, okay, it is what it is. The system is parameterized itself. I don't know what those parameters are. There's a number of things influencing it. What we can do is we can take a glycoprofile. So you can take a protein. It's going to have some sugar chains dangling off of it. These might be the only four you actually measure on there, the potential thousands. And you can use those to basically sketch out the pathways that are active in your glycosylation network. So you go from that network with tens of thousands of reactions, you can bring it down to something a lot more manageable. And then you can basically say, well, whatever is influencing the cell in that state, if I perturb the cell, if I just knock out a gene, a lot of those things will stay the same. And so what you can do is then predict the change after knockout, gene knockout or something like that. You can predict what the knockout will look like. So if you think of it in the flux space, you could have flux going through the metabolic flux going through all the different pathways in the Golgi. You can stimulate like that, but again, that doesn't give you adequate constraints. And what you're doing right there is you're by looking at translating this instead of the flux, instead of translating it to probabilities of each transition, you're kind of fixing all those enzymatic parameters into your model. And thinking of them just as, well, it's more likely to go this way than this way. And it's going to be about 40% chance this way, 60% chance that way. And so what will happen is if you do like a gene knockout, if you knock out that gene that catalyzes that reaction, you can say, well, most of the flux is going to then shift that way. Some of it might spit this out, but most of the flux is going to be this way. So you can basically predict how the flux will be redirected when you when you do a gene knockout. This allows us to avoid having to worry about the enzyme kinetics. Does it work? So we took something very simple. We looked at a recombinant antibody. Again, these are the three glycans that were detected on it out of the potential thousands. We ran the model of what would happen if you knock out FUT8. Very simple one. Just basically, we should just remove that sugar. And this is what our model predicted. And that's what was experimentally measured. Okay, this is good. Very simple knockout. This is just a sanity check. It worked. Okay. What about something more complex? Here's EPO. EPO has three different N-glycosylation sites on it. These are what the sugars look like, the dominant sugars that they were able to identify out of the thousands of potential ones. Our model predicted if you knocked out GNT4, which is very important for branching of your glycan, this is what we predicted what you would get, and that's what was experimentally measured. Okay, still pretty close. Again, these are out of the thousands of potential glycans that could be made. What about something a little more complex? Well, if you just look at the secretome of a CHO cell, this is what it looked like for the one we had. We knocked out one gene. This is what our model predicted, and this is what was measured. So we missed a couple glycans, but by and large, we captured the bulk of the changes in glycosylation. Okay, this is all going in knowing what the modifications are that you're going to want to make. What if you don't know what the changes are that you're going to want to make? What do you do? What if you have, for example, you want to make a generic drug? These are called biosimilars in the biopharmaceutical space. You know that a company is making huge amounts of money producing Humira, so you want to make your own version of it and sell it. You have to match the glycoprofile. In fact, this is one of the biggest challenges in the biopharmaceutical industries. How to take your cell, which is producing a glycoprofile like this, and get it to match the approved drug, which has a glycoprofile like this. And so, how do you do that? Well, again, I don't know the changes I need to make to do that. Well, we can use a genetic algorithm to find that change. So you can take your model, you parameterize it. These are the glycans you have. Use that to parameterize. This is basically your starting state. I just have it shown in gray. And then you randomly increase some of the values or decrease them and make a whole population of mutants. Glycoprofile or basically models that would produce a glycoprofile that would be a perturbed version of this. Then you can compare them all to see how close they are to what your target is. You identify those that are the closest. You mate them and you mutate them, basically changing these parameters, mixing these parameters and changing them of the best ones. And you go through this iteratively until you find something that is as close to this as you can get. And so you can see that after a number of generations, you can get closer and closer and closer to get this one closer and closer to that, where this is a metric of how different those are. And it will tell you basically how you're going to change individual enzymes in there. So you can see that over the process, you want to knock down FUT8 activity to 2% of its normal activity. You want to increase GalT to 130% of activity. You just want to slightly tweak GNT1. And after that, you can basically get pretty close. Okay, so makes sense. Now, not all cells are going to be produced starting with the same glycoprofile. So as you can see right here, here's two examples of two different cell lines that have different glycoprofiles. This one, you can see it's already partway there to getting it. So probably the better one, right? Well, you can test that. You can basically test all of your different cell lines and see which one is going to be the easiest to get there. So you can then run the model on all of them, and it'll give you the predictions, how you perturb them. And what you'll see right here, the one that seemed like would be the best to start with is, it's okay, you're getting there, but there's some discrepancies there. This might cause you some challenges with the FDA and getting it approved. Whereas one that seemed like very different, again, is very close. So you can use this to actually identify the cell line, potentially use this to identify the cell lines that are going to be getting the best glycoprofile. So in summary, glycosylation is one of the biggest challenges for many of the biopharmaceutical companies. You can use these to delineate the pathways for protein glycosylation. We're able to use modeling to net techniques based off of constraint-based modeling and other approaches to predict the interventions you'd want to achieve a given glycoprofile. And I didn't show it here, but you can also use this to identify how genes that don't seem to be related to glycosylation ultimately impact glycosylation. That's some exciting work we're able to do in some more basic science applications. So again, these are these unique challenges to the biopharmaceutical industry: is boosting the quantity, improving quality, and reducing the time. And there's a lot of different strategies that we can now use now that we have the genome sequence modeling techniques and genome editing technologies to address these. So in the last few minutes of this, I'm just going to give you a quick rundown. So what time do I have, Tel?
About 15 minutes?
Okay, yeah, I can go over this. And this is something that I think you might find interesting. I talked about making cell line specific models. Different cell lines are gonna have different profiles. Now, I've been talking so far about CHO cells. This is gonna be relevant to different cancer types, different tissues, and so forth. You have to figure out how to accurately capture what are the metabolic pathways in your tissue or cell type to really get an accurate view of how you might perturb it for a disease condition, or how you might, or what is going on in your cell line or in one cancer type versus another. I mentioned that you want to be able to get cell line specific models, but there's a lot of other diseases, metabolic diseases, where we see perturbations in one person's metabolism versus another. And this is a major challenge in pediatrics, is that you have a number of metabolic disorders, genetic metabolic disorders that influence their growth and development. In cancer, there's basically all of the different cancer hallmarks right here that are really well known. They're all connected to metabolism. One of them is metabolism, but again, all of them are connected to metabolism one way or another. And even to start looking at the microbiome, a lot of the interactions we look in our gut are actually metabolically rooted. These microbes are going to be consuming and producing different things and influencing their interactions with various tissues. So how do we properly model cell type and tissue-specific metabolism? So again, you build a genome-scale metabolic network model, as we already talked about. You can tailor a metabolic network reconstruction for a specific tissue and cell line. And eventually, through this process, by overlaying omics data, you can get a model. But is there one model or are there multiple? Well, the problem is there's a lot of decisions that must be taken in producing a cell line specific model. First, you gotta figure out which algorithm to use. Here I just show five of them. And so it's pretty easy. You go to your favorite bioinformatician and ask him which one's the best one. And of course, he being very up to date on the literature, knows the impact factors of each journal. So he'll go for the one that has the highest impact factor, right? Or he'll say, oh, my friend in the seat next to me developed a tool that of course it's better than everybody else's. And so they'll use that one because it's the easiest to use and so forth. So you have to figure out one way or another which is the best method that is able to give you a model that best recapitulates the metabolism of that tissue or cell line. Then many of these algorithms require you to define a threshold. Now what do I mean by threshold? You're frequently thinking about whether a gene is expressed or not. So where do you cut it off? This is the FPKM values for a cancer cell line. Do you call these expressed and these ones not expressed? Or do you say that all of these are expressed and these aren't expressed? That will significantly change your model, right? And so what I've heard in conferences, someone just say, oh, we used an FPKM of one that seemed to give us a good answer. So that's right in the middle. And so ideally you want to understand the impact, how these different decisions impact it. Then you have to worry about constraints. Sometimes you'll have information on which metabolites are being taken up or secreted from that tissue or cell line. Sometimes you won't. So the question is, can you get away with modeling without that information? Or how much does that improve the prediction? So you can either leave all of your exchange reactions open, or you can constrain them by directionality or magnitude. To hopefully get something that recapitulates the metabolism better for your cell line. So there was a nice study just almost 3 years ago from Marcus Hergard's group out in the Technical University of Denmark, in which they took a number of these algorithms, the ones that were able to predict the flux distributions, and they compared them all for E. coli. What they did is they took these algorithms, basically predicted what the topology of the network should be, and predicted the flux values from them using these various algorithms, and then compared them to metabolic flux data, so fluxomic data that was measured. And they checked to see which ones were, how close were they to, were the models to the predicted fluxes. And they were able to score them. So you can see right here for E. coli and yeast, you have all these different algorithms. Now, one of them right here is PFBA. This is just an assumption of minimal metabolic flux with no data overlaid on it. And a low score is a good score. And so if you look at these, they're all pretty much lower than all the other algorithms. So it's saying, basically, that all these methods are worse than not using transcriptomic data. And so this was kind of a frustration. Now you start thinking about that. You think a little bit about the data. Fluxomic data is a measure of metabolomics data that's mapped to an assumed metabolic structure, which is usually complete. And so it could just be the fluxomic data, since it was built off of a model that had everything in it. Of course, it's going to be closer to the non-tailored one. Or maybe E. coli and yeast have evolved to have very efficient metabolism. And so our algorithmic assumptions might not be as accurate as what this assumption of minimal flux has been able to, or basically the evolutionary pressure of minimal flux on these cells. So that left a number of us scratching our heads after we saw this paper. It was a very nice study, but very important for us to think about the idea of, do these algorithms mean anything? Especially when we start thinking about tissue-specific modeling, because they're used quite heavily in tissue-specific modeling. And so I was thinking, like, well, in human metabolism or cell line-specific metabolism, there's a lot of different pathways. There's a lot of specialization of different tissues. These probably still work, I hope, because we really want to understand the cell type-specific metabolism. And so some of these different approaches, I won't go through too much in depth on them, but GIMI, for example, will minimize the number of reactions that are added after you hit a certain threshold. It actually minimizes the flux of reactions that have to be added to be able to meet metabolic objectives. Others will minimize the number of reactions that are added. Others will identify first a core set of reactions they know should be in there, and then they minimize the number of low expression reactions that are added into it, while bringing in as many reactions as possible that are highly expressed. And so these are going to be FastScore, MBA, and Cadre. And so there's a number of different algorithms out there that take different approaches. Which ones are better? Which ones will work better? And so what we did is we took the human reconstruction one and basically built three different models from this, just using different constraints on the input and output. So we used exometabolomic data to constrain the fluxes, either the direction and quantity, or just the directionality of flux in and out of the metabolites in and out of the model, or just leaving them all open. And then we used a number of different algorithms with cell-specific RNA-seq data for four different cancer cell lines, and built hundreds of models, different models, using these different parameter sets. And then went through and did a systematic evaluation of their ability to predict a couple fundamental metabolic activities. And so first, just looking at those hundreds of models, how much do they vary? This is the number of reactions in the different models for these four different cancer cell lines. We get some models that have just had under 600, as actually far fewer reactions. And some of them have to 1,800. So there's a wide range of different types of models you get, but just by varying these parameters across what would be seemingly meaningful levels. So it makes you kind of think about, well, maybe these decisions really are important to understand. So what actually influences the spread? And so it shouldn't be too much a surprise, but your threshold significantly impacts it. So if you use your top 10% of the genes as being expressed, these are here in red versus other cutoffs. So you're down to half of them basically what would be the FEKM1. You can see that just in the first two principal components, you can clearly see a separation based off the threshold. It's not till the third principal component that you can see the constraints that you put, whether the metabolites coming in and out of the cells. And so we looked at the different principal components. We found that, sure enough, the threshold was the most important for determining the size of your model. Okay, nothing too exciting, but it makes sense. But it suggests that we really do want to understand the impact. But what you also see is in all the components, you see the method pops out as being very important. It's not until the third, as I mentioned, that you get the constraint being important. So we started looking into, this is just the content of a model. What about the function of a model, right? Well, what can these models do? I'm pretty sure Bernard has mentioned this, but there's a number of different exciting things that these models have been able to do. And since the early days, in 1994, they had a study come out where they were able to show the metabolic functions of a cell. They were able to show that as a cell, as E. coli grew to higher and higher conditions, the glucose would drop off and there'd be this secretion of acetate. So basically, these models were able to predict a physiological function of a cell. Then you had studies where they were able to show that you're able to simulate gene essentiality quite accurately. You're able to predict most of the essential genes in E. coli. And there were other studies where you're able to see that you're able to simulate optimal growth and basically an evolution towards optimality. So we decided to take some of this, some of these same ideas in the cancer space. First, can we predict gene essentiality in a cancer cell line? So we used data from a number of CRISPR-Cas9 knockout screens. Basically what you do in these, you print off guide RNAs against every single gene, load them into a virus, infect a population of cells so that each cell has a different gene knocked out. You run off selection and sequence the guide RNA of those that survived, and those that fell that were missing are the essential genes, right? And so it's a little messier than that. You usually have a distribution of essentiality, and we can see that when we actually compared this to the model, we were looking to see if the model, if the genes that were predicted to be essential by each of these hundreds of models we built, if they were, if they showed a significant decrease in abundance, in other words, that they were essential, compared to the non-essential genes that were going to be sent around zero. And we developed a metric for that. And what you can see right here, if you compare the accuracy, so basically this is a scaled metric, where one would be whatever you get for the genome scale model, you can see that the accuracy increases for almost all of the extracted models. Almost all of these cell line specific models were better predicting gene essentiality than your genome scale model. Whew. So these algorithms, even though they did not behave well in E. coli or yeast, for human metabolism, they do seem to be working. And it works for almost all the models we built. So we started looking to see, well, what influences the efficacy of these cell of these models to be able to predict essentiality the most? So we looked at the thresholds, and we saw that as you got so now in this case, these ones, the further down you go, the more accurate it's going to be, because we're using a p-value here. You end up getting more accurate gene essentiality predictions if you have more stringent thresholds. So it suggests that what gives you the most signal are the kind of the core proteins that are highly expressed. We also found that you only had a slight improvement by adding on the constraining the models accurately with very well measured metabolomics data, but it's still an improvement. What we found, however, was the biggest effect was which algorithm you used. Okay. So you can see right here, if you use no algorithm at all, you'd still have some level of accuracy, but all these algorithms were better than nothing at all. But as you can see here, I won't name names, but okay, they're all right there. But you can see that some of these algorithms, especially init, MBA, and MCADRE, were giving far more accurate results. Okay, so it kind of gives you an idea that, of which algorithms you should probably start migrating towards. More importantly, though, this gives you a workflow that you can do to test your own models to make sure when you're developing algorithms or developing models for a tissue, what you should go after. And so we actually found that method selection was the most accurate one. You can see combinations of threshold and methods. You can find just kind of sweet spots right here. These are all right there. If you look across the board, you have to look carefully at the paper. MCADRE is usually the best one. Now, of course, there's some bias there. The senior author of that paper is my brother-in-law. So a little bit of nepotism there. But anyways, these methods all here seem to behave well. And then just to wrap up, we decided to look at metabolic functions. Now, oftentimes you don't know what your tissue does. You have some ideas. You're like, okay, it does a few of these different things. It produces these amino acids, or it produces these molecules. but you don't know everything it does. So what we did is we took 56 functionalities that were essential to cancer cells for growth, and we checked to see, I'll skip over this, but basically how well these models are able to predict functionalities if you don't tell the model that it knows how to do that, that it needs to do that in the first place. And we found that a positive score up here suggests that these models are able to actually accurately predict metabolic functions that you didn't tell the model it should be able to do. Okay, so just that these, that overlaying these algorithms allow you to actually predict novel functionalities. There is a correlation with the number of reactions, so it's something to think about when we start thinking about the size of the models I talked about earlier. If you're interested in this, go and look at the paper. These are, right, this is basically a whole bunch of different metabolic functions, and then how many of, what percentage of the models were actually brought those in. You can see there's a few functions that the models with whatever algorithm or parameterization you use, they just were not able to predict it. And so the question is why? So I'm just gonna go over a couple really quick. We found that for phosphatidyl inositol, it cannot be produced in 61% of the models. And even though phosphatidyl inositol is actually in the model. Now why is that? You have a highly expressed gene that uses phosphatidyl inositol, that's forced. And so the algorithms will all say, well, I just need to get this reaction in there and functional. And so what it does is it brings in a thermodynamically infeasible loop. And so so basically your model can run this to its heart's content, but there's no net increase in phosphatidyl inositol, and so it can't be secreted. So you want to look into issues with this, where it's just an issue with the threshold, and these reactions which weren't added because they were below threshold. Another one was the synthesis of tryptophan. Now, of course, it has to be taken from the media. We have this gene right here that's highly expressed, but the problem is a lot of the algorithms, if you have too many low expression reactions, it'll kick out highly expressed reactions. So that's what happened here, where this reaction was kicked out because none of these were expressed. And that's because the GPR, the gene protein reaction association, was not complete for this reaction. You also had a few reactions without GPRs. And so again, you can remove if you do not pre-specify and enforce the functionalities. It can remove reactions. Many of them will automatically remove reactions without GPRs. And you have other reactions that were blocked and incomplete with incomplete GPRs. And so in summary, the network topology of your cell type or tissue-specific model is influenced mostly by threshold, but its functionality is influenced by the method you're using. Most of the method of metabolic functions can actually be predicted de novo, and there's actually a trade-off between functionality and accuracy, so that's something you want to think about. Bigger models tend to be less accurate. So you want to think about, and then you also need to, when you start thinking about using these transcriptomic data to actually predict new metabolic functions, you got to be careful and look at your model, because sometimes metabolic functions can be missed because of areas of improvement, either modeling assumptions of the algorithms, or incomplete models. So, which we hope will be addressed in the future as we learn more and more about human biochemistry. So that's my presentation. I think I ran out of time, so I'll be happy to answer any questions if anyone afterwards. So.